Once, they ruled the waves. Today, their shattered remains lie twisted on the ocean floor.
We just watched this scene of devastation unfold in front of our eyes. It was shocking.
Each wreck, a memorial to hundreds or even thousands of lives lost.
They had no way of knowing that, in fact, these were enemy aircraft just about to make their attack.
Only by examining the physical evidence.
These torpedo holes in this vessel, they're big enough to drive a bus through.
And taking into account the unpredictable nature of war.
It is essentially a suicide mission, a one-way trip, a kamikaze mission.
Are we beginning to understand why?
All hands on deck! This is not a drill!
After hundreds of years, the age of the battleship comes to a sudden and violent end.
One of the bombs hit the number two turret. It just blew the heck out of everything.
These wrecks tell a story, if we're willing to listen. 3 million shipwrecks lost in the depths of the ocean.
There's the bow. Wow, she's pretty.
Each a time capsule, hiding stories of adventure, innovation.
The number of holes in that wreck is quite remarkable.
Courage and tragedy.
We're talking about the deaths of 10,000 people.
Now the hunt is on to find the ships, unlock their secrets.
Imagine being in a haunted house with a small flashlight.
It's sinking!
That I lost my hold and fell.
It was a terrible crash at the vessel, sir.
I was the only one to come back.
Others sank to the bottom.
And hear their voices once again. An expedition is underway in the North Atlantic. Somewhere out here, 2 miles below the surface, rests the only remains of a shocking World War II shipwreck. David Mearns is determined to find it and hopes to learn more about why it sank and why so many died on board.
I was prepared to search an area that was 600 square nautical miles, roughly the size of urban Paris, so an enormous area.
The ship he is looking for is the HMS Hood. At the time of her sinking, she is the largest and most famous ship in Britain's Royal Navy.
HMS Hood is the top symbol of British prestige in the interwar period, the mighty Hood.
Hood sank in May, before the US or Soviets had joined the war as allies. David has clues from witness reports. He's plotted coordinates based on them, but each one is different.
So I'm left with a rectangular box, approximately 620 square nautical miles. In the center of that is a smaller box outlined in red where the predominance of clues all sit. That's my high probability area.
His plan is to crisscross this area, towing a sonar device on 30,000 feet of cable. Designed to work at extreme depth, the sonar creates a sound map of the seabed.
We're putting sound into the ocean like you put a light on an object. And light on an object, if it's standing high above the base area, you're going to have a shadow behind it.
It's a massive undertaking, but a huge prize. Prior to having US or Soviet allies, losing the Hood was a devastating blow to Britain and catastrophic for a crew.
When we started turning to port, we were hit, and the whole ship shook, and a lot of debris and bodies started falling all over the decks. She started going down by the stern.
Hood was gone in under 3 minutes. From a crew of over 1,400, only 3 men, Bob Tilburn, William Dundas, and Ted Briggs, were left alive.
I could see the bows of the Hood standing vertical in the sea. It was a vision which was to recur in nightmares for the next 40 years.
Once I met the men who had served on Hood, particularly Ted Briggs, the last of the three survivors, everything changed. Ted was a boy sailor, 16 years old, and lived the rest of his life with this great event on his shoulders, carrying the loss and the memory of all these men. It became a very personal quest.
David wants to solve the mystery of why the Hood sank so quickly, leading to the devastating loss of life. And there's something about the accepted history he wants to investigate further. His team searches nonstop for 39 hours.
There's anxiety, there's trepidation. Are you going to find it? Am I looking in the right place?
They're looking for a sonar shadow that could indicate a metal object.
That's a piece of something.
I think this is it. There's a second one coming with a shadow. Two pieces. That's it. That's Hood.
A wreck that had been lost for 60 years, then one moment it pops up on your screen. It happens that quickly. And as soon as I saw this image, I knew that the ship was badly damaged.
The damage David can see was inflicted by another famous warship, the Bismarck.
No ship was bigger, no ship was faster, no ship was more powerful than the Hood until the launch of the Bismarck.
At the time the Bismarck was launched, it really was the ultimate expression of the battleship art.
German High Command tasks Bismarck with attacking convoys, bringing vital supplies to Britain. The mighty Hood was sent to challenge Bismarck, setting the stage for an epic clash between two titans of the seas. But it wasn't a fair fight.
Hood and Bismarck are not evenly matched. Bismarcks are new and modern, and Hoods are pretty old. Hood is an old lady by the time we get to 1941.
Early morning on May 24th, the two warships meet in the Denmark Strait. At 5:52 a.m., Hood opened fire. And Bismarck returned it.
A great sprouting explosion burst from the center of the Hood. Enormous tongues of pale red flame shot into the air. The Hood had literally been blown to pieces.
By 6:03 a.m., it was over. Eyewitness reports of the battle recount one explosion. But David sees evidence in the sonar images that challenges the established narrative.
This is the initial sonar image of finding Hood. Generally, when you see a shipwreck, you have one clear debris field. But to see two like that, that was unusual. It was telling me a story of two separate explosive events. I had never seen anything like that before.
David sends in a remote camera to get a closer look.
And we just watched, over the next 20, 30 minutes, this scene of devastation unfold in front of our eyes. It was shocking and it was very upsetting.
It's like peeled open like a can opener.
Lost for 60 years, the British flagship HMS Hood has been discovered at the bottom of the North Atlantic Ocean, nearly 2 miles deep.
As we were approaching that, we were finding more and more bits of small pieces of wreckage, torn, twisted ship structure, steel.
Shipwreck investigator David Mearns is trying to decipher a scene of utter devastation.
Finally, we came across this large piece of the ship, and it was open. The internals were all exposed. The sides were all torn and twisted, and you're trying to make sense of it.
Evidence from sonar mapping And now these images from the seafloor do not immediately match official accounts of the Hood's final moments, accounts that have been unchallenged for decades.
The magnitude of the explosion and the rapidity with which the ship disappeared led to the conclusion that the after magazines exploded.
The shot that sank the Hood was in many ways a very lucky one.
One of the first salvos struck home, pierced the deck armor, and detonated in the aft powder chamber.
That moment when Hood explodes was shocking for both sides. Heart-stopping moment when a ship that size just explodes and disappears in seconds.
What we know is that Bismarck's shell hit Hood in the aft part of the ship near the mainmast. There was this enormous explosion like a blow lamp.
But evidence at the wreck site points to a different chain of events. And according to David Mearns, an alternative theory about the Hood's final minutes. A key clue is the Hood's huge conning tower.
This is a 600-ton cylindrical piece of structure that was found nearly 1.5 kilometers away from where the rest of the ship were. Now, how did it get that far away?
The presence of two distinct debris fields containing the stern and the bow, and the conning tower's separate location nearly a mile away, all lead David to a startling conclusion.
What was clear to me is that there wasn't just one explosion, there was two explosions, and that the forward magazine also detonated. To me, that was the only explanation.
Eyewitness reports state that the Hood's rear ammunition store was hit, which caused her to rapidly sink, stern first.
I could see the bows of the Hood standing vertical in the sea.
And as described by Ted Briggs, the bow rears up, and that's the moment all the cordite that would have been stored in the forward magazine has now been shifted up like that. In a matter of seconds. It all falls against bulkheads. It's being sent everywhere. That causes the explosion.
For anyone left alive on board, the second blast was a death sentence.
Hood explodes, blows the bottom out of the ship, and she's gone. And there is no chance to get off that ship. Many of them would have been trapped in compartments inside the ship as she went down.
It is now clear why Hood sank so quickly and took so many of her crew down with her. Today, the wreck is a protected war grave. The research team guides a remote vehicle towards her broken bow and places a plaque in memory of the 1,415 sailors who perished with their ship.
For the German propaganda, this was a great success. A German battleship had sunk the pride of the Royal Navy.
After sinking HMS Hood, the Bismarck seemed invincible. But just 3 days later, she too would lie at the bottom of the Atlantic Ocean. How were the British able to catch, corner and destroy the Bismarck, a ship that had seemed so powerful just days before?
The Bismarck was a big ship. She was a proper battleship. She's got a crew with officers and men in excess of 2,000. Belt armor, almost 13 inches thick. She's a formidable beast.
However formidable, the British were now more determined than ever to see their enemy's greatest warship destroyed.
J.
Churchill makes it pretty clear that he wants the Bismarck sunk. This was payback time.
Today, nearly 16,000 feet down, this is all that remains of what was once the most feared battleship in the world. Her shattered hull and the testimony of her survivors bears witness to the violence of her final moments.
Bismarck looked like a heap of scrap metal, all on fire. Men were running back and forth, trying to find a way of saving themselves. It was chaos and desolation.
If you look at the wreck today, the number of holes in that wreck is quite remarkable.
In her clash with Hood, Bismarck sustained only minor damage, but critically, she started leaking fuel.
Bismarck has been hit, and Admiral Lutyens has to decide that as he's losing so much fuel, that he will make it back to France. He starts moving back towards the Bay of Biscay and the French ports, and hopefully solace and repairs.
Bismarck raced for the safety of German-occupied France, pursued by over 40 ships from the Royal Navy.
The story of the hunt of the Bismarck is one of the most dramatic in entire naval history.
Crucially, the British task force included two aircraft carriers, Victorious and Ark Royal.
The Atlantic's a big place, and it's very easy to lose yourself in it.
So the Bismarck vanished in the Atlantic.
But Bismarck was now leaving a trail of oil. And late in the morning, on May 26th, an RAF pilot located her.
She's not far now from the air cover that she might get from occupied France, so there really is only one shot left to try and stop Bismarck before she reaches safety.
The British battleships were too far behind. So the task fell to a squadron of Swordfish torpedo bombers aboard the carrier Ark Royal.
The Swordfish, it looks like something from the First World War. It's an open cockpit, biplane aircraft, basically made of struts and canvas.
As flimsy as they look, they were strong enough to carry one ship-killing torpedo each. And as the light fades, they get a chance to use them.
It's utterly David and Goliath. And as soon as they emerge from the cloud, the Bismarck sees them and puts up a withering barrage of anti-aircraft fire.
Against the heavily armored Bismarck, the pilot's chances were slim.
Most of the torpedoes miss. Torpedo attacks are a lottery in those kind of conditions, but there are two hits.
The first explodes harmlessly on Bismarck's thick belt of armor. But Swordfish pilot Jock Moffat and his crew have more success.
I felt that every gun on the ship was aiming at me. It was coming at us like hail. Every instinct was screaming at me to duck, turn away. Getting closer and closer, the ship was getting bigger and bigger. Then he said, "Let her go, Jock."
Close examination of the wreck reveals the location of the torpedo strike.
The key hit was on the stern.
Here, below Bismarck's steel belt and below the waterline, hides her weakest point, the steering equipment.
The rudder was mangled together with the central propeller.
From the moment Bismarck's rudder was jammed, her fate was sealed.
That night, Admiral Lutyens sent a chilling signal back to base.
Ship unmaneuverable. We will fight to the last shell. Long live the Führer.
As the sun rose, the British battle fleet appeared over the horizon. Only able to steam in circles, Bismarck was an easy target.
And the British are able to open fire on her.
And they just keep hitting her.
It must have been terrible moments for these more than 2,000 young men on board.
There are descriptions of her being on fire from stem to stern. Eventually, she rolls over and goes down.
Of Bismarck's 2,200 crew members, only 115 survived. Two mighty warships sunk, 3,500 men dead, and one of them lost, in part due to a strike from the skies. And these won't be the last battleships to sink that way.
All hands on deck! Man your battle stations! This is not a drill!
Six months after the Royal Navy's battle with the Bismarck, Japanese warplanes attack Pearl Harbor. Today, in the shallow waters of the harbor, lie the fractured ruins of the flagship of the American Pacific Fleet.
It just shook the ship like it was a piece of paper. The fireball went 400 or 500 feet in the air.
The wreck of the USS Arizona is now a memorial commemorating the US Navy's darkest day.
December 7th, 1941, you have the day of infamy, the start of the war in the Pacific and the Far East, and it begins with a Japanese surprise attack on the US fleet at Pearl Harbor in Hawaii.
Arizona was moored on Pearl Harbor's Battleship Row, displacing around 30,000 tons and stretching 600 feet. She is an impressive sight.
I'd never seen anything that big that would float.
Arizona was heavily protected with a steel armored belt over 13 inches thick. But evidence from the wreck reveals a fatal wound.
The crack that runs through the entire ship, that's major structural damage to the vessel.
How could such a huge, well-armored battleship be so completely destroyed?
Pearl Harbor is at peace. It's a Sunday. This is a completely unprepared base. It's not ready to be attacked.
In contrast, the Japanese had been planning what they called Operation Z for nearly a year.
The six Japanese aircraft carriers left in secrecy from Japan 2 weeks prior to the battle, and they crossed the Pacific without being seen.
Maintaining a strict radio silence, the Japanese task force was 230 miles from Pearl Harbor on the morning of December 7th. But they already had the American battleships in their sights.
We look at battleships and we marvel at the fact that they can fire shells the size of a small car, maybe 20 to 25 miles. That is extraordinary. But if you think of an aircraft as the projectile fired by an aircraft carrier can fire its projectile hundreds of miles, and that battle fleet cannot fight back.
So they launched their aircraft at about 6 a.m. to attack the American battleships, waiting completely unaware in Battleship Row in Pearl Harbor.
As Japanese warplanes approached, they were spotted by U.S. radar.
They saw blips on the radar scope. The blips themselves could not be identified.
The operators assumed they were looking at American planes.
They had no way of knowing that, in fact, these were enemy aircraft just about to make their attack.
Just before 8 a.m., pharmacist mate Sterling Kale came off shift and was stunned to see planes right over Battleship Row.
We don't train on Sunday, but then as I was watching, a plane came by with the rising sun on the fuselage, and I said, my God,
Those are Japanese planes.
Aboard the Arizona, Lauren Bruner was looking forward to shore leave.
After church, I had a date to meet a little gal on the beach. Her name was Nikki. I never got to see her.
Then he heard a message over the ship's PA.
All hands on deck! Man your battle stations! This is not a drill!
The first wave is 180 aircraft coming in, and suddenly they're hitting their battleships with bombs, torpedoes. It's a total surprise, and it's a total shock.
Led by Commander Mitsu Fuchida, Japanese bombers targeted Battleship Row. They were armed with a new airborne weapon, a 16-inch battleship shell adapted to be dropped from an aircraft.
Ignoring the barrage of shells bursting around us, I pulled the safety bolt from the bomb's release lever.
Armor-piercing shells are extremely heavy because there's a lot of mass in the front of the shell. Think about a sledgehammer with a pickaxe front.
A single bomb dropped by a Nakajima B-5N from about 10,000 feet plunges through the armor next to one of the turrets, drives into one of the magazines, and detonates the ammunition that's stored in that magazine.
A huge column of dark red smoke rose to 1,000 feet, and a stiff shockwave reached our plane. I saw that a big explosion had been on Arizona.
As with HMS Hood, it was Arizona's own munitions that sealed her fate.
It's not a lucky hit, it's what they were aiming for. Everybody understood that if you hit a gun magazine, the secondary detonation would tear the ship apart.
Arizona is an enormous and powerful warship, and she's defeated by a single bomb from a single aircraft.
Herb Weatherwax, then a 24-year-old Army private, remembers the terrible moment.
That explosion was so great that it killed everybody on the lower deck. It touched my heart. These are all young people. They went to bed, they never got up.
The fires and the explosion take 1,177 lives.
When you dive the wreck, you see things left in the galley, bowls, spoons, forks. Fire hose still snakes across the deck where damage control parties were working when the final blast came.
Japan had only just begun. And 6,500 miles to the west, another mighty battleship was about to discover the deadly consequences of ignoring the threat from above. ...73 miles off the coast of Malaysia lies the wreck of HMS Prince of Wales. One of the most modern battleships in the Royal Navy, she fought the Bismarck alongside HMS Hood. But in the days after Pearl Harbor, her crew struggled with a very different enemy, Japanese warplanes.
I managed to crawl over the deck to the rails and saw others in their panic slide down the side of the ship.
The ship that helped sink the Bismarck was fast, maneuverable, and well-armed. Yet she was unable to survive a sustained air attack. Divers are investigating the wreck site as part of a military expedition. On board is wreck explorer Rod McDonald.
My role in this expedition is basically to try and work out exactly why the wreck sank. When this vessel was built, it was a state-of-the-art battleship.
One of the most advanced battleships of her day, Prince of Wales had a radar-guided firing system, 20 watertight bulkheads, and a thick belt of anti-torpedo armor.
It's so intact that you would actually think if you filled the holes, you could actually float it today.
She had defenses against shells, bombs, and torpedoes. but her designers could only do so much.
You can armor a battleship as heavily as you want, but every battleship has its Achilles heel.
15-inch thick steel covered her down to 10 feet below the waterline. But below that, there was little protection.
These torpedo holes in this vessel, they're really quite big. They're probably about 25 feet across, big enough to drive a bus through.
All the hits on the Prince of Wales were below the belt. So how did the ship's attackers exploit this vulnerability so successfully? To deter a Japanese offensive, in November 1941, Winston Churchill sent a Royal Navy task force to Singapore, Force Z. Prince of Wales is the flagship.
With the object of keeping Japan quiet, we are sending our latest battleship, Prince of Wales, which can catch and kill any Japanese ship.
Churchill believes that the entire Japanese Navy is supposed to be deterred by a force of two battleships, Prince of Wales and the battlecruiser Repulse.
I think there was an underlying feeling that, well, the Germans are one thing, perhaps, but, you know, these Asians in the Far East, well, you know, maybe we don't have to take them quite so much as a threat.
Force Z's escorting aircraft carrier was damaged, so it went to sea without air cover. But Commander Admiral Sir Tom Phillips is unconcerned.
Tom Thumb Phillips is one of these dyed-in-the-wool, old-school Navy admirals. He was a big believer in the big gun. He doesn't think that airplanes could really do much damage to his ships.
No battleship had been sunk by air attack at sea. A maneuvering ship was quite hard to hit.
Early morning on December 10th, a force of 88 Japanese aircraft located the British task force.
At the time of the attack, Prince of Wales and Repulse were headed back to Singapore. They were 150 miles out from the safety of home port. To see Japanese planes coming in such force was a rude surprise.
The British suspected they were high-level bombers because these were the only known Japanese aircraft with the range to reach them.
When the attack comes in and it looks as if the aircraft are forming up for a torpedo attack coming in low and fast, an officer on the bridge says, "No need to worry, sir, they can't be torpedo bombers, they haven't got that range."
Torpedoes were a much more potent threat than bombs.
Even the officers and men on board don't believe that they're under torpedo attack until they see the torpedo trails in the water, and then they realize what they're up against.
Unknown to the British, the Japanese Navy had developed long-range aircraft capable of carrying powerful torpedoes, and nine of them were racing right for the Prince of Wales. Witness reports that at 11:44 a.m., she was hit.
She's hit on the port side, right at the stern, in the propeller shafts by a torpedo, and from then on, it's game over.
Rod McDonald believes this one strike is critical. To see its impact, he examines the ship's outer propeller tube.
When I dived the wreck, I saw where the tube had been and the shaft was thrashing around. All the metal of the ship's hull has been peeled back and opened up.
The propeller itself is missing.
When the shaft itself fell away from the wreck, it made a far bigger hole and water started to get into B engine room very, very quickly.
This had done for Bismarck earlier in the year, and it did it for Prince of Wales.
To understand how one torpedo hit condemned the entire vessel, naval historian Anthony Tully has come aboard a battleship of similar design.
This here is a propeller shaft. We see its length running the length of the ship, and this runs this way through each compartment. Because of the torpedo hit, you had a bent shaft rotating out of alignment and tearing like a giant corkscrew up the length of the ship. And you can imagine this making a shivering motion until it entirely breaks apart.
The bulkheads were designed to be watertight, but as the propeller shaft broke free, it ripped through them and water flooded from stern to bow.
So from this one torpedo hit, Prince of Wales had lost both inner and outer portside propellers. And she took on a list.
As the hull tilts, it exposes this vulnerable area under the hull to even more torpedoes coming in from other directions.
Three more torpedoes struck below the armor belt.
As the ship began to founder, began to sink, so HMS Electra, one of the escorting destroyers, came alongside.
Some in their impatience tried jumping across onto the destroyer's deck, only to fall in between both ships to be crushed or drowned.
Prince of Wales and HMS Repulse were both sunk. 840 British sailors went down with their ships, including Admiral Tom Thumb Phillips.
I turned around and saw the Admiral and Captain Leach on the bridge, saluting the flag as the Prince of Wales slipped beneath the surface.
The significance of this moment is it's the first time that a battleship in open water has been destroyed entirely by aircraft.
It wouldn't be the last. An era of naval warfare would reach a tragic end with the destruction of the largest battleship ever built.
You are being requested to die gloriously, heralding the death of 100 million Japanese who prefer death to surrender.
Was the Yamato the first and last kamikaze battleship? An ominous cloud floats over the East China Sea. It's all that's left of the 80,000-ton super battleship, Yamato. She sunk with the loss of over 3,000 lives.
Perhaps Japanese sailors' first duty was to die for the emperor, and many did that day.
60 years later, an international team of wreck explorers is on the hunt for the Yamato. Once the flagship of the Imperial Navy, she has acquired an almost legendary status in Japan since she met her doom in 1945.
The Japanese battleship Yamato is the pinnacle of battleship development. She is inconceivably huge. She's fast, she's capable, but in the end, she's a battleship. And by 1945, the battleship has absolutely had its day.
180 miles off the Japanese coast, sonars detect wreckage on the seabed. Deploying submarines, the team wants to find out what sunk this colossal ship. 1,100 feet down, strange shapes emerge from the gloom.
It's anchor.
Yeah.
It's anchor. Main anchor.
She looks large enough to be the Yamato, but the team needs proof.
This is a symbol.
Yes.
The chrysanthemum, emblem of the emperor, a badge of honor carried only by capital ships of the fleet. This is the Yamato. Her twisted remains speak of a violent end. Among this wreckage, thousands of young men lie entombed with their ship. In the dying months of World War II, Yamato was ordered to attack invading American forces. Many of the crew already knew their fate.
This was our final sailing. This giant ship, now departing, would never return.
By the time Yamato goes into action in 1945, the Japanese Navy is a shadow of its former self. Many of its ships have been sunk. All its carrier aviators, that cream of its pre-war trained carrier flyers, they're all dead.
The loss of the Prince of Wales proved that any battleship without air cover was a sitting duck.
There are no illusions that it is essentially a suicide mission, a one-way trip, a kamikaze mission.
On April 6, 1945, Yamato was sent to engage American forces at Okinawa, but was spotted by a U.S. submarine. The next day, planes from 8 aircraft carriers were sent to attack her.
I went down, dropped my torpedo, and went right across the bow of Yamato.
The battle was completely one-sided. The Japanese fleet had no air cover, while the Americans had over 400 aircraft launched from aircraft carriers and captured airfields on Okinawa itself.
Over 1,000 feet beneath the surface, the results of their attack on the ship are shockingly clear. Yamato didn't simply sink. She was blown apart.
The wreck reveals a hull broken in two right at the forward number two turret.
By 2 p.m., after 90 minutes of constant attacks, Yamato was finished.
As the waves and waves of aircraft keep coming into attack, Yamato is attempting to outmaneuver them, but torpedoes just keep slamming and slamming into the port side of the ship, and it's only a matter of time before the killer blow comes.
Men jumped into the water to save themselves, but at that moment, more torpedoes struck Yamato, causing her to capsize.
That was where the magazine erupted.
Destroys the ship utterly and kills 3,000 men almost in a stroke.
Yamato, the ultimate battleship, proved powerless against the new rulers of the waves.
An enormous column of smoke pours into the sky, forms a huge mushroom cloud, which really symbolizes the death of the battleship as the preeminent naval weapon.
The age of the battleship, in tactical terms, has ended, but they still remain the symbols they always were, of potent national power.